we are trying to push this forward to biomedical use, is such that eventually, so now we're trying this in mammals, and so eventually you will have these wearable bioreactors, not just for the limbs, but potentially for all organs, that would provide the correct bioelectrical payload in terms of ion channel drugs. So that would then trigger the growth. Not trying to control every aspect of it, because you have no idea how to do that, but to provide a trigger stimulus. And the final thing that I want to show you is the ability to induce novel organs. Just to kind of nail the idea that what we're doing here is reprogramming the pattern memories of these cells. So I showed you that little eye spot in the electric face. And we wondered what would happen if we reproduced that same pattern somewhere else. So what you can do is inject into this early embryo RNA encoding a particular ion channel that produces a little pattern of particular voltage. And sure enough, those cells get the message and they build an eye. Okay, in this case, on the gut. These eyes have all the same layers, retina, lens, optic nerve, all the same stuff. And just notice what this means. First of all, it means that bioelectrics, of course, as I've shown you in these other examples, is instructive. It's instructive at the organ level. We did not have to say which genes to turn on. We didn't have to tell the stem cells what to do. We found a high-level subroutine call that says, build an eye here. Okay, and the cells are very competent at doing that. The material, as I was pointing out, is not only competent to receive low information content stimuli and then have a very complex downstream response, but also it does this cool thing that other collective intelligences do. For example, ants. When ants come along a piece of food that's too big for them to move, what do they do? They recruit other members of the community. Well, these cells do the same thing. If we inject a few cells, they can tell there's not enough of them to build an eye. So what do? They recruit a bunch of cells from the environment that we did not inject at all. So there's the ability for the material to scale itself to the available to the message that they receive. And just to point out, if anybody's interested in plants, this is another great example of the plasticity of life. You might think that the oak genome encodes for this shape, because this is what you see most of the time. These acorns give rise to exactly this shape, this flat green thing. But along comes this non-human bioengineer, this wasp, which is a parasite, which puts down some signals for the plant cells, and it hacks them. It hacks the morphogenesis exactly the way that I've been showing you that we can hack the morphogenetic outcomes in animals. And it causes these plant cells to build this incredible spiky round thing, or even this stuff. So these are galls, and we would have had no idea what these cells are capable of if we didn't see this amazing example of a bioprompting or reprogrammability. And in fact, it's kind of interesting that the sophistication of what is built is roughly parallels to the sophistication of the hacker. So bacteria and fungi make these kind of boring, lumpy things. Nematodes and mites do a little better, but by the time you get to insects, you get this beautiful kind of construct. So this is what we're trying to do. Is it took millions of years for the wasps to be able to do this. We want to accelerate this process. And so the last example I want to show you is a new kind of technology. Which are basically synthetic biopods. So when you look at this, you might think that this is something we got from the bottom of a pond somewhere, but actually I could tell you that if you were to sequence it, it's 100% Homo sapiens. These are human adult tracheal epithelial cells. We have a process that allows them to reboot their multicellularity into this little creature. It's self-motile. Now, why is this interesting for biomedicine? What does this do? Well, and by the way, you would never guess that the human genome would make something like this. This is nothing like any stage of human development. Well, one thing they have the capability of doing is healing wounds. So if you make a bunch of human neurons in a culture like this, and you put a big scratch through the middle, right? So kind of a wound assay, and then you put these bots into their environment, they form this thing called a super bot cluster. And here you can see what they're starting to do. You lift them up 4 days later, you see that what they've done is knit the two sides of the wound together. So who would have thought that your tracheal epithelial cells that sit there quietly for a long time, kind of getting rid of the mucus and so on, are capable of having a completely different life in a different different form factor, with the ability to heal some of your wounds? And this is just the beginning. This is just the first thing we discovered. They probably do a lot more. And so we're envisioning these anthrobots as personalized autonomous therapeutics. In other words, they're made of your own cells. If we inject them into your body, you don't need immune suppressing drugs. You're not going to reject them. They biodegrade within a few weeks. And in the meantime, there might be many applications in which these things could be cleaning out joints, looking for cancer cells, dropping off pro-regenerative molecules, fixing up neural connections, and so on. And so the bottom line is this. Much of biomedicine today is focused around these bottom-up technologies, so at the level of the hardware. But there's a whole a frontier of medicine that's opening up, which are these top-down interventions that take advantage of the intelligence of the living material not to micromanage molecular states, but to convince the cells to and reset set points. We can train them. Here are the electroceuticals that I've been showing you, right, which are basically just signals to get the bioelectric pattern memories shifted in the right way. And of course, AI is going to be very important in enabling us to communicate to all the different layers of the body. So my claim here is that future medicine is going to look a lot more like a kind of somatic psychiatry and not like chemistry, because the name of the game is going to be to really take advantage of the intelligence of these other layers of the body. And the final thing I will just say is that because of the plasticity of life and because of the innate problem-solving capacities of tissues, pretty much any combination of evolved material, engineered material, and software is some kind of possible embodied mind. So in other words, cyborgs and hybrids and augmented humans and weird kinds of creatures that you could only begin to imagine. Some of these already exist. Many are coming. They will be here with us in the future. And that means that we need to let go of old categories around living things versus machines and all that, because the entire variety of life, what Darwin called endless forms most beautiful, are a tiny corner in the space of possible beings. And I think we need to take very seriously the idea that this technology is not just about fixing all of the medical situations that plague us today, but also to release a kind of freedom of embodiment where people really can reimagine their life in a very different way than the body they happen to have been given as an accident of the trial and error process of evolution. And we need to really work on a new way of synthbiosis of living up in a mutually beneficial way with beings that are going to be different from us. So I'll stop here. I'm just going to thank the postdocs and the students who have done the work that I showed you today. We have lots of amazing collaborators. I thank our funders who have supported this work, and the disclosures of these are the companies that have supported us over the years. So thank you very much, and I will stop there.
Awesome. I think the work that Michael Levin is doing is Nobel Prize worthy, if you ask me. And the things that he's saying are not just really interesting and have deep implications for biology, but it's for life itself, for computing, for this idea of sentience, right, Tyler? Right, sentience. And so we actually have a very diverse crowd in the audience of physicians, students, academics. There's even high schoolers that are here. And I did want to ask Michael if you have maybe a couple of minutes if you wanted to take a question or two from someone.
Sure. Yeah, okay. No problem.
Who's got a really good question?
I was very interested in your slide about this theory of cancerous cells failing to communicate electrically with their neighbors. One of the vague things I do know about larger tumors is that they do start to coordinate with other cancer cells and become more dangerous for the body. Is there a potential avenue for research of disrupting the coordination within cancerous cells so that you get a meta cancer that sort of helps the body?
Yeah. Great question. Yeah, absolutely. And we're working on this. I mean, basically, after the individual cells disconnect from the normal network, they will eventually end up connecting within themselves to form something else that again tries to reinflate that cognitive light cone that was shrunk to the level of a single cell, and then they make a tumor, and then they compete with the rest of the body. And so, yeah, that process is absolutely a good target for cancer therapies, and we're working on this stuff now.
Thank you for a very interesting presentation. I just want to ask, in regard to the plasticity of cells, how do you see the relationship between the bioelectric signal about and epigenetics? Is that sort of software versus hardware, or how do you see that?
Yeah, great question. And I have a talk on my site that's about an hour just exactly on that question. To briefly sort of address it, Yeah, the software-hardware analogy is actually pretty good in this case. The genetics is what specifies the hardware available to cells. So the genetics tells every cell what ion channels it's going to have, what voltage transducing machinery it's going to have, and so on. But everything that happens after that is really a function of the physiological software, which is both bioelectrical, but also biochemical, biomechanical, and so on. And we have a number of cases, and in this lengthy talk, I go through all of them, where you can actually see where the information diverges completely, where if you track the genetics or the transcriptomics or the proteomics, you get the wrong answer. And I kind of showed you this already, you know, in the case of the tadpole, when you look at the mutation, you would make a prediction, oh, it's going to have a brain defect. And that's in fact not what happens. In the cancer example, you would find the oncogene mutation. You would say, okay, it's going to have a tumor. And again, you'd be wrong, because the genetics gives you some information. And for certain things, that's sufficient. But for many things, especially these kind of anatomical outcomes, looking at the hardware is just not at all sufficient.
So wonderful talk. I just have a quick question.
At this point, a listener asks whether biology has a unifying theory akin to the Langlands program in math or theory of everything in physics. They note that biology currently consists of fragmented disciplines like genomics and proteomics, with no overarching framework to unify them. They wonder if bioelectricity could be a key foundation, or if something more is required to develop a comprehensive theoretical model of biology.
Yeah, thank you. That's a very good question. Let me clarify. Bioelectricity is only interesting because it happens to be the cognitive glue that enables the scaling of intelligence. Forming into bioelectrical networks is how the tiny little goals of single cells, metabolic goals and proliferative goals and so on, are scaled up into grandiose goals like building a limb or a face and so on. It is the cognitive glue. That's why it's interesting. It's otherwise not special by itself. But it happens to be very convenient, and that's what evolution has chosen. I would claim, and so this is a controversial claim. This is not the mainstream view. So take this with whatever grain of salt you want. But here's my claim. I think there is a general theory of biology that is being developed now. I mean, obviously, this is what we're trying to do, and some other people. And that theory is going to be in the shape of things familiar to behavior science, not things familiar to physics and chemistry. I don't think you should be looking for equations. I don't think you should be looking for emergence, complexity theory, dynamical systems theory. These are all nice, but these are not the backbone of biology. I think the backbone of biology and things we call life are just systems that are very good at scaling up the cognitive properties of their parts into bigger and bigger light cones.
New update. Started a Substack. Writings on there are currently about language and ill-defined concepts, as well as some other mathematical details. Much more being written there. This is content that isn't anywhere else. It's not on Theories of Everything. It's not on Patreon. Also, full transcripts will be placed there at some point in the future. Several people ask me, hey, Curt, you've spoken to so many people in the fields of theoretical physics, philosophy, and consciousness. What are your thoughts? While I remain impartial in interviews, this Substack is a way to peer into my present deliberations on these topics. Also, thank you to our partner, The Economist.